Hi, my name is Josh Mayersky. I'm a graduate student in the MIND Lab here at UC. MIND stands for Microelectronics and Integrated Systems with Neurocentric Devices. Today I'm going to be talking a little bit about biologically inspired computing and specifically why we might want to do that. But before we get there, we need to talk more about specifically what is traditional computing? What is a computer? How do we know what it does? So when we think of computers, typically we think of something like a desktop that's sitting on our desk and we interface with it through a keyboard, a mouse, and a monitor. We might also think of something like our phone, where we hold it up in front of our faces and we click around using our thumbs or our fingers. Really, all a computer is a system that has some inputs, something like a keyboard and a mouse, some black box, which we'll talk about in a second, and then outputs that are sent or displayed to us in some manner, typically via a monitor or a screen of some kind. That black box, though, is specifically what we're really interested in. So inside that black box, we have a multiple different components that talk to each other. The key and core component is something called the central processing unit. That central processing unit talks to memory, what we're going to call main or external memory. This is information that is stored permanently in a mechanical hard drive or a solid state drive, if you're familiar with those. This central processing unit is made up of three different core components. So you have the CPU, the processor, which is then made up of three different things. Those three different things are something called a control unit, an arithmetic or logic unit, and then you have temporary internal memory that's specific only to the CPU. So, the basic function of this CPU is kind of threefold. You have the first step, which is something called fetching, and this is where the CPU is going to be talking to the external memory. It's going to pull information that has been permanently stored and temporarily store it inside the CPU, inside the control unit. The next step of this process is going to be called decoding. This is where the computer, the central processing unit, then has to decide what it wants to actually do with the information that was then pulled from the main memory. So first we have fetching of information from permanent memory, then we have interpreting of that information. The third step, when it actually does something with the information, is called execution. This is where, based on how it interpreted the data, it actually executes a particular function, whether it be adding two pieces of information together, subtracting them, moving them from one location to another location, something like that. The issue with all of these is that it's doing it in cycles. So it goes fetch, decode, execute, then restarts, fetch, decode, execute, fetch, decode, execute. It keeps doing this multiple times, such that one of these cycles is called an operation. So what we do when we want to say that a particular processor is faster or slower than a different one, we say that it has a higher operations per second. So if it can perform more operations in a given time period, we say that it's a faster processor. So if we're going to be talking about this particular architecture, anytime you have memory separated from the main processor, so the external permanent memory and the internal processing unit, that's called a von Neumann architecture. It's named after a computer scientist by the name of John von Neumann, who died sometime in the 1950s. The point is, this particular architecture has just become so prevalent in today's world. We see it in our phones, we see it in our computers, our desktops, everywhere. All of this technology has been progressing at such an exponential rate, and this particular way of improving upon itself is basically following this quote-unquote law called Moore's Law. Really, all this is saying is that the fundamental building blocks that we use to construct these computers, the number of those building blocks is doubling, or rather, we can fit double the amount of those building blocks in a small area about every 2 years. And that law has held for the past 20 years or so. But we don't think it's going to continue. And the reason that we don't think it's going to continue is that we're actually reaching fundamental limits in terms of the materials that we're using and what we know of physics is preventing us. We're getting down to such a small size with these fundamental building blocks that we actually can't even see them with the naked eye, and it's been that way for a long time. But it's getting to the point where they're so small, we cannot make them any smaller. So, what exactly does this mean for us? What does this imply if we can't move any farther in terms of how far we can shrink these fundamental building blocks. Well, first we should probably talk about what the shrinking actually does. So by shrinking these fundamental building blocks, these transistors, just a fancy word for a switch, something that goes on and off, by shrinking these building blocks, really what we're doing is we are increasing the processing speed. So we're saying we can perform more operations per second on a given processor. And at the same time, because memory is based off of these same fundamental building blocks, we can store more information. So we can store more information as we keep shrinking, and we can also increase the speed at which we're interacting with and processing that information, which would be great if we could just continue on this path and we keep increasing our memory capacity and we keep increasing our processing speed. But because we're reaching a fundamental limit in terms of how small we can make these, we need to start thinking about alternate methods of computing, different ways where we can still keep this increase in processing power, processing speed, and memory capacity. And that's where bioinspired computing comes in.